Good morning, and I'd like to welcome everyone to this, the ninth meeting of the Standards, Procedure and Public Appointments Committee in 2024. We have received apologies this morning from Oliver Mundell, MSP, so Edward Mountain, MSP, is joining us today as Oliver's substitute. Good morning, Edward. Our first agenda item is for the committee to agree whether to take item three in private. Agenda item three is consideration of the evidence heard on the Scottish Elections, Representations and Reform Bill. Are members happy to take that consideration in private? Thank you. Our next item is for the committee indeed to start taking the evidence on the bill. And we are joined this morning by Alam Hamoud Al-Bashiri, the Peer Education Coordinator for the Scottish Refugee Council. Good morning. Alice Kinghorn-Gray, who is the Campaigns Officer for the Electoral Reform Society in Scotland. Good morning. James Adams, who's Director Scotland for the Royal National Institute of Blind People. Good morning. And we are joined online this morning by Hannah Stevens, the Chief Executive Officer of Elekta. Good morning. And Kay Sillers, who's the Regional Manager of Unison. Welcome to all. If people are content, I would like just to press on with the questions, with the proviso that don't feel you need to answer every question, but please feel free to contribute to a question that you would like to. And I am going to turn, I think, in the first instance, to Jackie Dunbar. Good morning, Jackie.
Good morning, and thank you, panel, for coming along today. I'd like to start off by getting your views on the proposed disqualification orders, if you don't mind. I would be very interested to hear on your any thoughts you've got, or in fact any insight you have on the level of intimidation, harassment or abuse that folk have got to endure during the elections. And I don't just mean candidates in this, I mean campaigners and also the very hard working electoral staff. Could I maybe start off with Kay Sillers, who's online, to get your perspective, Kay, because you've probably had to deal with it on the staffing side.
Hi, morning. Thanks for inviting us. I think this is a really important issue. One of the aims behind all of this is to increase participation in our democratic processes. And if it is an unpleasant thing to participate in, whether as a candidate, as a member of staff, or just a member of the public wanting to ask serious questions, then people are increasingly backing out of it. It's not for them, it's not for me, I'm not interested, and I think we see that across all sorts of surveys, people just not wanting to participate in political debates in our country. And certainly no one should experience violence at work. And I mean that in the widest sense of violence. You might not physically be injured by people screaming and shouting at you, but it still has an effect on your day-to-day life. And anyone who has experienced that kind of intimidation knows how your heart goes up, you panic, it sits with you for the whole day. So it's not just the event, it's going into work the next day thinking it might happen again. So I think that from our point of view, particularly local government staff who tend to be our members, it's really important that some serious action is taken to protect people at their work. But I think that goes across some of the things we've seen to candidates and just people generally participating in our process. We would like it to be something that... Would elections be something we'd look forward to? I would like to think so, that people would see themselves as empowered and willing to take part in a process. I'd be interested to hear what Hannah says, but I think in particular women are intimidated out of our political processes.
Okay, thank you. Can I maybe ask Hannah then for her views? And also, sorry, I should have also asked if you thought that people from minority backgrounds are affected differently, or disabled people, or folk who identify as women. Are they all? Do you think that they're? That the level of abuse is more or about the same? And I realise how bad that question sounds, and I don't mean it the way it comes across.
Certainly from our experience of our surveys of our members in their day-to-day working lives, there is a lot of abuse related to people's protected characteristics, for a better expression. And so I can't see, we've never asked that specifically around elections, but we've certainly asked it around people's day-to-day working lives, and it shows in all of that work.
Thank you. You explained it so much better than me. Can I go to Hannah, please?
Thank you so much. Thank you for the opportunity to join you today. At Lecter, we've been speaking to hundreds of women over the past few years about their experiences of engaging in democracy at every stage, right from the very beginning of wondering what it is and how it relates to them, through to getting involved, whether that's with a political party or not, and choosing to follow an independent route, through to candidacy, and then now more recently, really engaging with women once they are elected in office. And we are hearing across the board what an enormous, enormous problem this is. And I'm really thrilled that the committee is taking this seriously and really looking at ways that this bill can continue to engage in this matter. I believe truly it's having a negative impact on our democracy. And the clearer that we get an understanding of the problem at stake, the more we can examine how we can work towards fixing it. Women absolutely categorically receive a greater amount of abuse, and women of colour an even greater amount on top of that. It really is. In the Amnesty research found that abuse targeted towards female MPs, that 20 minority ethnic MPs received almost half of all the abusive tweets that were put out there. So that's a social media challenge. We have to absolutely understand that those with additional positionalities are receiving increased amounts of abuse. So I'm excited that you're exploring this, but we do feel that the bill at this point only looks at preventing a person from standing as a candidate if they have committed an offence. And I think there's so much more that can be done in order to continue to tackle this issue. The Jo Cox Foundation has several recommendations that I think are really relevant to this conversation. One of those is clear guidance for elected representatives on reporting abuse to police. We've had lots of conversations with women who simply don't know what their rights are in terms of reporting that abuse and how best to engage in it. And the conversation has to be around women in elected office, but I'm also really pleased that you acknowledge those that might be activists or campaigners, because there are lots of misogynistic abuse happening within the culture of political parties as well, which is initially the first space that people might start to get involved in democracy. So some of the Jo Cox Foundation's recommendations are this clear guidance for elected representatives in reporting abuse, greater financial support for elected representatives to deal with the costs associated with the personal safety and handling abuse. I think our financial systems aren't yet up to speed with those additional needs. If, for example, a member is recommended to avoid using public transport for a period whilst they are on the receipt of abuse, there are increased costs that come with that. And the wider points that we'll discuss later, I imagine, within the bill about increasing public trust and engagement in the democracy. We really believe that that wider conversation is a really important part of it as well. I think there's a deep lack of understanding of what our elected representatives are doing for us. And I think the democratic education piece is a really important part that does connect to this conversation. And finally, Jo Cox also recommend the training for police and law enforcement about their responsibilities for dealing with threats against elected representatives. I know Police Scotland have been doing some good work with COSLA to develop this, and I'd really encourage the growth and development of that work.
Okay, thank you. You actually answered my second question at the same time, so thank you very much. Is there anyone that would like to add anything? Because my next question was going
Just before you move on to your next question, Jackie, just can I come back, Hannah, about what you would like to see in the actual bill? You make reference to the Jo Cox Foundation recommendations, which the committee are aware of. And then you highlighted the one about guidance, which could in fact happen notwithstanding. Are you looking for anything specifically in the bill, or would I'm going to use this phrase and it's going to come back and haunt me, a declaration in the bill of the intentions of other legislation, statutory instruments and things to bring in the guidance? Would that go some way to reassuring you so that the intention as to the environment I think we all want can be achieved, rather than specific calls in the bill in primary legislation?
I'm afraid I would say I don't feel like an expert enough in the structure of bill development to determine which way that information should be best presented. But I would say that an acknowledgement of misogyny and racist misogyny within any relevant part of supporting literature around the bill, I think, is absolutely vital to truly articulate the reality of this situation, which is that women and minoritized women, more specifically, are receiving a increasingly larger amount of abuse than the men in this system.
That's helpful. Thank you. Sorry, Jackie.
No, thank you. I was just going to ask if anybody had, if there was any other things that the rest of the panel thought that could be considered, that we could consider implementing into the bill. I don't know if anybody has got anything else to add.
I suppose specifically with regard to... is it the sort of intimidation and harassment,
yes,
side of it? So, I mean, I suppose opening up, Alan's probably the person to come to. Is there anything that you would like to see specifically in the bill with regard to the situation with both the proposed changes to those who can stand, but also actually the experience that refugees have and those that have the right to vote and their interaction in the electoral process?
Yeah. Thank you so much, Convener, and thank you so much for giving us this opportunity to come to here today and to give an evidence in your committee meeting. And I'm happy actually to back to you and answering this question by writing. But the things I want actually to comment about it in here, maybe you will come actually asking me about it. It is about extend the right to people with limited leave to remain to stand in the election. And I'm really so happy that you include this in this bill, because that it was before in 2019. And I myself, yes, I'm here to speak on behalf of the Scottish Refugee Council, but also to speak as a refugee from refugee community in here in Scotland. Because
specifically,
I don't mean to cut across,
we will very specifically come to that, because I know that you have very valuable evidence on that. We're really just trying to explore it in manageable chunks and looking at the disqualification, but we absolutely will come to that.
Okay.
And more than happy for you to write to us afterwards on this point on intimidation and things.
Okay.
Jackie, can I just come back to you to... Do you want to do the...
Yeah. My next question, yes, thank you. It's the policy memorandum of the bill includes the disqualification of MSPs and local councillors who appear on the sex offenders register. It's not provided for in the bill, but the Scottish Government have said that they're going to be actively considering ahead of stage two of the bill. So I would be interested to hear people's views on this, on whether they think, you know, if someone is on the sex offenders register, should they be able to stand for or even continue to start to hold office, not just in the Scottish Parliament, but also for local government?
Kay, can I come to you first on that?
Sorry, I was just going to come back in on the earlier point, I apologise, but it was just to say that we won't be able to administer our way out of this problem around violence. And what we actually need is action around it. So there are plenty of rules already to deal with violence, intimidation. We actually just need people who are supposed to do something about it to actually do something about it, whether it's your manager or the police or anything like that. On to sex offenders. to say it's not something widely debated in unison. We haven't had a lot of, how can we empower people on the sex offenders register to take part in our democracy? So... but I don't think it's something that we would want to go down the road of. Sex abuse is about violence and power.
What I meant, Kay, was that currently, if I know that if someone is put on the register, that they can actually remain as a local councillor, and there's nothing that we can do to remove them from that. So that's what I basically was asking. Do you think there should be something in the bill that helps the process to remove that person, or do you think it should just remain the same? I don't know if that's more helpful.
No, I shouldn't be so sarcastic. I think that it is important that we have powers to remove people who commit that sort of offence. It is a position of power. They manage staff.
And trust.
At a basic level, and trust, but also they have access to the community and a position of respect in a community that could give them opportunities for further abuse. So apologies for my sarcasm.
No, thank you very much. Unless the panel's got anything else happy to hand back to you.
Thank you. Ivan, can I come to you?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. We've already briefly touched on it, Alan, but it was round about the issue of extending rights of candidacy to foreign nationals with limited right to remain. So if you want to take the opportunity to give us your perspective on that, that would be very helpful, and then we can open it out to other members of the panel.
Yeah, thank you so much. I will just repeat actually what I was saying in the beginning, that I'm here also to speak not only on behalf of the Scottish Refugee Council, but also to speak as a refugee from refugee community in here in Scotland. Because I myself, in 2019, I came to here to the Parliament to speak about that when we were campaigning to give the right to voting in national and local election for refugees and also for asylum seekers, and also to give the right to stand in the election. And I'm really so happy in 2020 the right for voting is being given for refugees in here in Scotland, and I myself as a refugee I can vote in national and local election in Scotland. And in 2021 when I went to cast my vote for the first time, that it was one of the beautiful moments in all my life. And I'm really so glad that I choose to make Scotland my country. And now I'm really so happy that we missed the opportunity to give the right to stand in the election for the people with limited leave to remain, and that includes refugees like myself. But now this has been included in this bill. So we have an opportunity to extend this right to people with limited leave to remain in here in Scotland. But we are, at the Scottish Refugee Council, we are welcoming this, but in the same time, we are disappointed because this bill is not included to give the right in voting for asylum seekers. And this is something we will continue to campaign for. And we are believing in here that by giving the right, it is a significant step toward inclusivity and also ensuring that everyone, regardless of their status, they have a voice in shaping the future of this country. And it doesn't matter from where these people come, what does matter that they choose to make Scotland their country and their home. And guaranteeing the right to stand in the election to people with limited leave to remain, it is a matter of fairness, equality, and also democratic principles. And this is recognition that contribution and also potential of individuals who have become a part of a society, but also may still have barriers to fully participating in political process in here in Scotland. At Scottish Refugee Council, we understand how crucial it is. We totally feel it when the refugees were given the right to vote in the election. One refugee who voted for the first time in the Scottish parliamentary election in 2021, the election that you have been elected in, he said, it's a beautiful moment to vote for the first time in my life. And just imagine, there are a lot of people, they are coming from the countries, these countries, they didn't a democracy countries like Scotland, and we are really, I myself also really very happy that I'm living in a democracy country where I can practice this right to vote for the members of the parliament. And also, we want you to to extend and give us the right to stand in the election too. Because if you are go today and walk in any street, if in Glasgow or in Edinburgh, you will see a lot of people, but these people, they are not represented in here in the Scottish Parliament. So we are talking about some people, their voices, it's missing, and also their issues, it is missing. It's very important to consider that. And it is essential to consider the voices and also perspective of all members of our society. Empowering these voices that we know that they have previously been marginalized and also underrepresented. Is it strength our democracy and ensures that decisions are made with full representation of our diverse population. Furthermore, it is a step towards removing any barriers for inclusion and also strength overall political participation and support the social and political integration for non-citizens in here in Scotland. And you know, we have one of very important policy. This policy, it is a new Scots integration policy. And in this policy, it is state that the asylum seekers, they integrate from the day one of their arrival to here to Scotland. And it is not from the day when they are guaranteed the refugee status. And this is what I believe in. We must treat people as a human being, not treat them based on their immigration status. And this is a very important why we are in here calling to give the right to stand in the election to people with limited leave to remain. Allowing, and just only finishing actually with this, allowing people who live in here in Scotland but they didn't have British citizenship to stand for election, this would make the Scottish Parliament more diverse. The cost of applying for the citizenship, it's very expensive. Some of the people in our country, they can't afford and pay for the fees for the citizenship. And the proposed bill would give people with limited leave to remain the right to stand in the Scottish election regardless of their citizenship status and to provide them with the opportunity to contribute and participate fully in the Scottish society. And we believe this is, it is about promoting democratic participation and empowering those who have chosen to make Scotland their home and also addressing inequalities in here. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Very helpful. And lays out clearly the very important perspective. Is there anyone else on the panel that's got a perspective on this they'd like to share? Alice, not any of her online? Okay. The other issue I was going to ask about was the issue of dual mandates, where MSPs can hold another office as a councillor or an MP, and just to get the panel's views on dual mandates and how appropriate that is. I don't know. Alice, do you want to kick off on that?
I'm happy to come in here. Is that okay with everyone? Hi, thank you. So, yes, I'm Alice, and just want to extend a thank you on behalf of ERS Scotland to the Convening Committee for having us. So, on dual mandates, we would quite like to see legislation brought in line with the Senedd, where basically we don't see a real reason that I think MSPs should be double jobbing, as is the other term for it. We don't see any real benefit to either the voters or our democratic institutions. So the legislation that already, Welsh legislation that exists, sets out what we agree with is quite acceptable. So if you're an MSP and you are a sitting MP, you have 8 days to resign your seat in the Commons. And if you are a councillor, then you have 375 days. So there's a bit of more leniency there. And also, we in the Senedd, they legislate for taking a leave of absence from the Lords. We'd probably like to see you, an MSP resigning from the Lords, but that's we don't. Just to reiterate, we don't see why there should be. We don't see any real benefit to having two jobs, as it were. So that would be our position.
Great, thank you. Anyone else got a perspective on that issue? No. Okay. Nice and easy. Thank you. Good.
Okay, I think you'd like
sorry.
To come in.
Have your hand up.
Sorry, all I was going to say is that I think I agree with the ERS in as much. I don't think it's very good or helpful for our democracy for people to have these dual mandates. The actual issue where it's created is because standing as a candidate is incredibly high risk for people. It's a huge amount of hard work and sacrifice with so. It's hard for parties to get people to do it. And I think some of the other things we're looking at around here, like making more people stand, making it easier to be a candidate, will also contribute to getting rid of the need as to why parties end up with, for example, their councillor standing as MSPs. Because, we need to make more fundamental changes to how easy it is to be a candidate. Obviously, it's always going to be high risk because it's a win-lose participation. So I can't see any harm to our democracy from changing rules in that way. But we do have to understand why we've ended up here in the first place and deal with some of that as well.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you. Alan, can I just come back with regards to the standing? Because one of the things that has been raised with us is the fact that... When an MSP is successful, obviously they have to take an oath of allegiance. And whether or not you see any potential challenges from an individual's point of view in taking that oath of allegiance, having gone through the entire election and succeeded, whether there are any unforeseen consequences that we haven't considered yet about requiring a new MSP, particularly if they have refugee status and all of that, whether there are any unforeseen consequences that may arise from that.
Maybe there will be concerning. It is about, we're talking actually about from which perspective you will deal or you'll see actually do this. And and for myself, actually, I see everyone, as I told you, actually, who choose actually to make Scotland their home, they must be given the same right. I myself, yes, I'm a refugee. And some of you, maybe you will see me through this label, but I didn't see myself as a refugee. I see myself as a human being, and I must be given the same equal rights like anyone who are living in this country. So why we are treating people based on their immigration status? And I think by giving this right, we also challenge the state quo. We start actually to go to build a country where everyone, they have the same equal rights. This is, I know, it is idle things, but I'm hoping and I have a big belief that Scotland can do this.
That's lovely. Thank you very much. Edward, I think you wanted to come in probably on the earlier point.
Indeed, Convener, thank you. And I have my own views on dual mandates and whether it's possible to do the job. I find it's quite intense doing the job that I'm doing already, so I'm not sure I'd look for another job as well. But we are in situations where councillors stand to become MSPs and get elected to become an MSP, and then there's... Because of the way the elections fall, Alice, there's about a year before the council elections. Do you think there's an argument that councillors who become MSPs should continue for that year so as not to cause an extensive cost to the taxpayers? They probably still can do that job for that short period of time if council meetings are on Mondays and Fridays. Do you have a view on that?
Just to say that, yes, there are those circumstances and we would agree, and that's why we would advocate for that 375 days per window as opposed to, say, the House of Commons and Holyrood. So, yes, we appreciate that there are certain circumstances if you're a councillor and you're elected to Holyrood. So, yeah.
And just Sorry, Commissioner, can I push it?
Can I just pause one moment?
Yeah.
Because where this discussion's going is not causing a problem, but I think there's something that that Jackie would like to put on the record, yeah. Although she hasn't contributed to this part of the discussion yet.
No, I haven't contributed to it, but I'd like to refer members to my register of interest, because I was a councillor for the first year that I was an MSP. And as Edward said, it was purely based on trying to save money, public money, because the cost of it would have been horrendous, because it was especially during COVID when by-elections were so expensive.
I'm certainly content that you fulfilled the responsibility that you have that. Edward, can I return to you?
And, Convener, you would know what the responsibilities of declarations of interest in this Parliament better than probably most other MSPs. My point then, just to take it to the next step, is that, you know, if you chose to stand for... to be an MP as an MSP, you're content that you would resign, or your proposal would be that you resigned if you were elected to an MP, that you wouldn't have to resign beforehand.
Sorry, could you repeat the point you're trying to make there?
So if you were an MSP, for example, and you stood for election to become an MP, you are content that if you then became an MP, that you would be given 8 days to... I think was the period that's being suggested,
yes.
to resign. Yes. You wouldn't have to resign before the election.
We think that in line with the Welsh legislation, that 8 days period is satisfactory.
Okay. Thank you, Camina. Those are just two simple questions. Sorry to put Jackie on the spot. Not.
Annie, can I come to you?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. I'd like to move on to free mail-outs. As you'll know, the issue whether to provide free mail-outs for candidates to local government was consulted on during this, as is the case that there is free mail-outs for Scottish parliamentary elections. And I'm just wondering whether you think it should have been included in the bill, or it should be included in the bill, and would it support diversity in candidacy? And I think maybe I see Hannah nodding her head, so I'll go to Hannah first, please. Thanks.
Thank you. I think the issue of finance around candidacy is a huge one that actually hasn't had enough attention generally in academia, in policy and research. So I'm really pleased that this specific initiative has been suggested. Standing for election is incredibly expensive, and I think it's more expensive than we realise, because we have candidate finance reporting, but that is just the cost of the campaign, and the vagueness around what is defined as the cost of a campaign is something that's becoming clearer to us. We now provide small grants to women who are standing for elected office to support them with the personal costs that they encounter in the lead up to the campaign. And through that period process, and through speaking to lots and lots of women about their financial needs during this time, we realised how much additional costs there are that aren't considered part of campaign finance. So any move that can be taken to level the playing field and to ensure that a wider range of candidates can consider it are to be celebrated. So we very much strongly support the free mailings as another opportunity that people can have their democratic right and stand for election without having to rely on additional financing to support those quite simple messages that they want to get out to people.
Hey, I think you want to come in on this point as well.
Again, to back up what Hannah said, it's high risk, it's very expensive in terms of your actual life rather than just the costs of standing for candidacy. It's already hard for people to do it on lower incomes. It's hard for people to do it who don't have the kind of flexible employers who would give you time off. It is incredibly difficult. And if we want, I think we need to do more than this, but I think this is a basic step that to some extent would level the playing field. Clearly, everyone in this room has stood for election and understands how hard it actually is. And we've come to a kind of time and place where it's really easy to mock politicians and laugh at them and undervalue their contribution. But actually, it's a really, really tough job, and getting there is even harder. And we need to take some serious steps to ensure that more people have the chance to stand up and get elected.
Thanks. Anyone else get anything to contribute? No, thanks very much. I'll move on now, and this is probably a question for yourself, Alice. How important do you think digital imprints are for transparency for the electorate? This is something that I think we've had quite a lot of discussion on, so I'm going to put you in the spot on this one, Alice.
Yeah. No, thank you. So the ERS has long campaigned for digital imprints and extending it from print to the digital realm. So the salience of these issues only increased in recent years. Obviously, we've seen between the 2015 and 2017 general election a doubling of the amount spent on Facebook adverts, just as one example. So it is a big issue for the ERS. We would like to see, our main point is we are concerned about the potential loophole that exists at the moment, and that we would like to see a monitoring of the scheme, basically, and because as it stands, it does state that the imprint must be included as part of the material unless it is not reasonably practical to do so. And then it says, then if it's not reasonably practical, I think that's the issue there, then the imprint must be included somewhere directly accessible from the material. So we would, yes, just like a very thorough monitoring to make sure that it's working as intended and that imprints are appearing on the material itself as much as possible, and there's no exploitation, basically, of the loophole. So that would be our key message there.
Yeah. Anyone else get anything? Yeah. Thanks, James.
Twice, my chair. Thank you.
James. And then Kay.
Is it me? Sorry. So it's not so much a point or a view on whether or not that be appropriate as an electoral administrative reform, but if that was something that was considered and was to come into place, then it's just a point I wanted to make around accessibility for blind and partial sight people, because if it is deemed important to be able to have an imprint so that any given voter or citizen can track, you know, where this advert's generated from or who's paying for it and what have you, which are important things in society, people who are blind and partial sighted, they obviously, unless the people putting out the social media, such as on Twitter or X, unless they themselves, be that a political party or individual candidate or whoever's the beneficiary of the reason for the imprint, unless they put alt text onto their social media images, that then becomes redundant for blind and partial sighted people. So it's just really, if that was to be considered and looked at, I just wanted to add that in as something to consider as part of it.
No, that's really really important, I think, as well.
I think Kay wants to come in as well.
I may well now have to reach out to James to make sure we are doing it properly. just to say that we're in the process of doing that for our digital imprints. It doesn't seem to be a huge cost or inconvenience. I do think it's something that is really, really important in an age of disinformation, that people can track and be clear about who is participating in our democracy and what they're saying can be tracked back. And I get that there are costs and all sorts of things, but it is so worth fighting for a participating democracy that is fair and open that we have to take all that into account. But I've made a noted point round the other issues there that have been raised.
Thanks very much for that. Thanks, convener.
Thank you very much. Really, sort of, I suppose, want to push this point and look at notional spend. And in particular, I think probably if I can come to you first, Hannah, because obviously there's proposals to change the notional spend within the bill. And it may indeed capture campaigners who previously weren't covered. And I know you made mention of grants and things like that. Do you have any comments, concerns about alteration in the notional spend that either could facilitate an easier progress for what you're proposing or indeed may indeed turn into a challenge?
Yes, I think it just requires a real detailed assessment of the specifics of the language, to be honest, and what we are suggesting, both in terms of fundraising, because if you increase spend, then there's more opportunities for fundraising, but that means that those that don't have access to that sort of fundraising haven't unequal opportunity. But similarly, we do see that there's a need to provide additional financial support to those that are candidates in order to balance out that playing field. So I think the detail in the language and how it's how what is defined as campaign expenses, as I mentioned, a whole heap of things that people, but specifically women, have to spend money on as part of the campaign that would not be traditionally considered that. You know, and at this current time in our lives, you know, several women, there are local elections happening in England at the moment, and we're supporting some women who are parliamentary candidates for the upcoming general election. And, you know, they're worried about the cost of living crisis. They're worried about being able to pay their electricity bills, and they're taking time off work so they can join campaigns. And so we're seeing this real kind of balance that they need to earn enough in order to continue to pay for their lives. Whereas would we expect those electricity bills to be part of their campaign expenses? No. But a query around what is defined as that. If we're looking for childcare so that I can go out campaigning, are my childcare expenses considered part of that, the campaign costs? And so, and we're really seeing, anecdotally, our evidence is really seeing a huge impact on candidates' mental health, actually, as they're really just stressed about so many different levels of the campaign and the abuse that they're facing, and therefore also the financing of it, and whether they're reporting correctly, which expenditures should be included and which shouldn't, and coming to us, and we're doing our best to support them, but the language is vague. So really our ambitions here, rather than being specific in terms of exactly what should be included in the bill, is to really give this the attention that it deserves, which I think historically it really hasn't been given, as I said, academically or in the policy space, to understand the realities of candidates' lives and experiences, and ensure that access to equality, and we're opening the opportunities to a wider range of candidates, is a key ambition as this legislation is developed.
So just before I come to you, Kay, because I know you want to come in, Hannah, you are sympathetic to the actual notional spend, so that there's transparency in expenditure. Would you go so far as to say that perhaps different levels of allowed expenditure should apply to different candidates?
Well, that's an interesting point that we haven't really explored, but I'd be very interested in kind of joining that conversation to see what that could look like. But yes, I would say that, you know, different individuals, if you're a single parent, you've got much, you know, completely reliant on both earning and supporting logistically your family, you have much different expenditure needs than, you know, than an employed person that has a fantastically sympathetic workplace that gives them time off, paid time to join the campaign. So that's not a particular point that we've looked into, but I'd be very interested to explore what that could actually look like. And I think that balancing, that's equity, right, in terms of giving different people different opportunities in order to balance out the field. And that's certainly what we're looking for in order to diversify the candidate pool.
Thank you. Kay, you wanted to come in.
As a trade union, clearly we are registered third-party campaigner. Yeah. We are a registered campaigner, and we fully support maximum transparency. It is, I think, that our money is the cleanest money in politics. It is the most open money in politics, because it's not just this legislation, but an array of trade union legislation that covers what we can do and how we can participate. I think that it is important that everyone else is held to account in the same way that we are. We don't do anything that is not open. We fully supported some of the lobbying bills. In fact, I'd probably call for those to be stronger. Openness is key to our democracy, but also to people's trust in it. And we're in a position where people, you know, I suspect that, you know, if somebody looks at this transcript, they'll be laughing at me for saying MSPs have got really tough jobs. We have very low levels of trust in our electoral politics, and part of that comes from a lack of ability to trace that money and the power that money gives you. We have to be really bold on this. And
thank
open.
You. Alice, did you want to come in on the notional spend?
Oh, yeah, I'm just nodding along with Hannah and Kay there. Yeah, I mean, I agree with them both, and I think there is that balance to be struck between accessibility and transparency, and the ability to, like Kay says, trace the money, especially as, you know, it is open to abuse by wealthy actors and other foreign states, and it is really, really key area in terms of our position. The ERS position is that we'd like to changes to be brought in along the lines of the UK Elections Act 2022. Mm-hmm. But I just to agree with the previous two speakers also.
Do you have any thoughts on different levels of expenditure? to reflect the characteristics of a candidate?
Again, like similar to Hannah, we haven't actually looked at that either, and I think it is a really interesting conversation that could be had, mm-hmm. Yeah. So would be also interested in joining that conversation where appropriate, but yeah, glad that it's been brought up.
Thank you. The next aspect of the bill is in relation to proposals for pilots during elections and extending it to the Electoral Management Board, the Electoral Registration Officers, to propose these pilots. Now, I've got a number of questions that I sort of wanted to explore about this, possibly coming to you first, James, in relation to are there any pilots that you would like to see being considered? Do you think extending the power to propose a pilot could go beyond the Electoral Management Board or the Registration Officers? And how do you see that being of value, particularly obviously to those members that you represent, which becomes a bit of a postcode lottery?
Yeah, absolutely, Chair. So essentially, there's been a ballot act that was passed in 1872, which guaranteed the right to a secret ballot. Unfortunately, even though it's been over 150 years, it's still not the case that all blind and sighted people feel that they're able to vote in confidence and in secret. And in fact, the last time we did, after each election, we always get a plethora of concerns and complaints raised with R&B. We then go and harass the politicians and the officials and so forth. It's like a big cycle that goes on. The last one in May 2022, which was R&B's turnout report, that found that only one in five blind and partially sighted people who took part in that work, only one in five felt they were able to vote in confidence and in secret. So, anecdotally, it basically means most people trust somebody else to vote, help them vote, be that an election official or a member or a friend or what have you. And that's not really, it must be possible to work out a way to try and get around that with modern technology and other methods. Now, in saying that, we do recognise the excellent work that's getting done by the Scottish Government at the moment in trying to evaluate and work out options for accessible voting. It's not straightforward. It's easy for me to say we can easily sort it. It's not that straightforward, of course, but they have to be able to go and test it. They're doing lots of tests, and we're working, and other sightless organisations are working with the Electoral Commission and the Electoral Management Board and the Scottish Government to try and identify ways to make voting more accessible. But at some point, the bullet's going to have to be bitten, and they're going to have to go and try it in the wild in a real, actual election. So that most likely be best placed within the context of a local council by-election. I think there's about 13, 14 on average every year. So, and for that to happen, by broadening out those who can sort of suggest that or make that decision to hold it, beyond just the local authorities, just the turning off local authorities to Electoral Management Board and perhaps the government itself, it just increases the likelihood that that's going to come to pass, because there can be all sorts of reasons why any given local authority doesn't want something complicated happening in their particular by-election. So being able to broaden that out to increase the number of stakeholders who can have that discussion, we think would make it more likely to be able to test an accessible voting pilot once one's identified that is worth testing.
And do you have confidence in that process of identifying the problem, identifying a solution and piloting it, which obviously will take a period of time, rather than solving the problem, biting the bullet and saying this is what's going to happen?
I think part of the challenge is that in Scotland, we believe it to be about 200,000, 183,000 people who are blind and partsighted have got significant sight loss. It's an awful lot of people, yeah. And all of them are individuals. So there isn't one solution to all of them being able to vote how they would want to. It's very hard to be able to do that. What you can do is try and make it as ubiquitous as possible, try and broaden out the accessibility as much as possible, then over time perhaps add and utilise technology as it comes available to try and make that process accessible. So steps that can be taken to improve, for instance, the accessibility of a ballot paper, or to update the TVD device, which is currently available was found unlawful by the High Court, UK High Court, by finding alternative ways to provide things such as that, which is what the Scottish Government is working on just now. They're trying to find ways of doing that, and in fact, they're actually doing some like sort of informal tests and trials this afternoon over in Falkirk. That's a really important thing to do. There is not going to be one solution. there needs to be steps towards it, because at the moment it's not accessible. So if that one in five people feeling confident about it can go up to one and a half in five, that is a big advance, because that covers thousands of people. So we know it's a long road, and we have got, you know, confidence that it's getting looked at, and that has been taken seriously by all the political parties and the Parliament and the government in Scotland.
So an extension to the proposal to allow the Electoral Management Board to make those proposals, you're in agreement with, subject to you being able, in essence, to go to the Electoral Management Board with perhaps proposals for pilots that they should consider, would be as satisfactory as we can get to at this stage?
I'm absolutely confident that would happen, because we're in regular dialogue with the Electoral Management Board, Electoral Commission, Scottish Government and anybody else who cares to listen to us on this issue. So we're regularly engaging. Part of the role we play is with other sightless organisations is we can engage blind and partial sight people to come to do informal tests. Obviously, in a real election, we would offer support where we could to put out communications and try and promote the fact accessible options are available, but that would be out of our control then, because it would be in a real context of a real event.
Thank you. I will come back to you, James, but I think, Kay, you wanted to come in on the pilot schemes?
Yeah. I think it's really important to try some of these pilots, and James has already intimated some really interesting things. But I think it's also important not to miss the point that we won't be able to administer ourselves out of this problem. Participation is particularly poor in local government elections, and actually candidacy is low. I mean, I think when we closed the candidates' deadline for the last local government election, some people were immediately elected on that day. And that's really quite sad in a, you know, ancient democracy of ours, that it's not more competitive. And it is about people's feeling that they can actually manifest change, and it is worthwhile bothering. Trade unionists are much more likely to vote than the population at large. And I think that is partly because we encourage people to vote in itself, but also they're people who are used to feeling power, to making and driving change and participating in democracy in its widest sense. So I think the pilots need to be about more than just the technicalities of voting, but about actual participation and power in the process. And so it's not no to that, it's just not in itself.
Thank you, Kay. Alice, you'd like to...
I would like to completely agree with Kay's point there as well. Quite honestly, we're quite disappointed not to see provision for automised voter registration, mm-hmm. Given that it was part of the consultation as well. So we would really like to see an amendment made, which would make a pilot. I think it would be included in the explanatory notes to the bill, which would make provision for that, because we have 19% of people eligible to vote in Scotland not on the register or incorrectly registered. It's not a panacea. We're not saying that we at the ERS also are looking at ways outside of elections as well to enhance our democratic culture. It's not just about elections, but it is such a vital step that we could use this legislation to potentially really move the dial on. We know there's a lot of research from the Electoral Commission that how this negatively impacts protected characteristic demographics, underrepresented and underregistered demographics. We at the ERS have done our own analysis that showed that the worst affected constituencies in England and Wales are around a fifth, so which is the same in Scotland, and that's the worst constituencies in England and Wales. We are going to have more research on Scotland specifically when that census data comes out, which I'm happy to share with the committee. But I would also be interested to hear some initial thoughts potentially from committee members, convener, on what they think about an AVR amendment potentially to the bill.
That's a delightful invite. However, I'm going to do the terrible thing and go, this is our evidence session and this is what we're looking for. Do you think automatic registration needs piloting, or is it something that could be achieved as, you know, a change in approach towards elections where at a certain point, as people grow old or indeed come into the country, there is automatic registration happens?
It
It could. It's just that this is an opportunity, I guess. Mm-hmm. And there's already a roadmap in, again, looking to Welsh legislation, yeah. With their bill that's just gone through. So we just see it as a real opportunity to... It's almost... It's there waiting, yes. Where yeah. We could just apply it here as well.
So in a sense... the concept of a pilot in just a small geographic area, do you feel is necessary, or do you have confidence in solutions that exist elsewhere? You've pointed to the Senate that actually could just be imported if that's what, as a parliament, we felt was the right thing to do.
Yes, I mean, we feel like a pilot would be a good first step. And okay. That's what the legislation in the Senate does, yes. As well. It's for a pilot, so they'll yeah. Be bringing in pilots on this. So. That,
yeah. Thank you. James, I was going to come back to you on it. I hooked it under this question, but it's actually a slightly different point in the evidence that was submitted, which is about electronic polling cards. And my understanding of the evidence, as I've read it, that's something that you would like to make sure that in the future could be brought in. Is there a reason that we shouldn't just bring in electronic polling cards along with physical polling cards at the moment? And are there any advantages, or what are the advantages to doing that?
Well, for blind parsight people, touched on earlier that, you know, all individuals as well, some are much more tech-savvy than others, as is the general population, but there is undoubtedly a large cohort of people who, if they were able, who are blind per sight, if they were able to, you know, register with the local authority to be able to receive their summation to vote, essentially, by email or by whatever electronic method, they'd be able to use screen readers on their phones and have that, you know, so they'd be able to read emails and be able to know about it. It just increases the likelihood that they would notice there's an election, you know, whereas if they get something through the post, then quite clearly there's a chance they'll miss it if not been able to read it. So as to whether we just roll it out straight away, I'd be a bit more sort of small-c conservative on that. I think you always need to test things to make sure it sort of works effectively and doesn't inadvertently, you know, cause some sort of problem which you hadn't anticipated. But it does seem fairly logical. Why couldn't you send out both? Mm-hmm. But I dare say there'll be some administrators somewhere who have good reasons why that's not as straightforward as it sounds.
So at the very least, a good proposal for a pilot?
I would definitely have it considered as something to try and do.
Thank you.
You could do both, couldn't you? You wouldn't risk missing somebody. You could send everybody the sort of polling card and then also try and persuade folk to sign up to get a digital one. Sure. It doesn't have to be just people. It could just be general population. Because over time, actually, you could just start to remove the... If people receive it digitally, they're happy with that. That over time could just be what it becomes the norm. Nice. That would save money, wouldn't it, essentially, if having to send out the polling cards.
Thank you. My sort of penultimate question really is, and I think, Kay, I'm going to come to you first because you made mention of this, but I do want to open it up to the whole panel. The bill will give the Scottish Government power to spend money on democratic engagement in whatever way they feel has been identified. What should the priority be for that funding? Because we've talked about, and Kay, you've mentioned, processes not the be-all and end-all answer to everything. So, you know, what should the priorities be for that funding, Kay?
I actually think that what needs to happen with the funding is it needs to go down to local areas. I think the funding itself should go to local authorities, and then local authorities should be able to decide what's best for them to start using in their communities, which then ties back to what I've said earlier, which is about that ongoing process of participation and encouraging people to both vote regularly but also more widely participate in processes, join campaigns, ask for things. And if you ask and you get used to the process of asking, then you're much more likely to keep asking, even if you don't always get what you want. And so, again, I think I feel as I'm repeating myself and I hope it makes sense. It's about localising that spend, localising the decision-making and the trials to allow people to participate. And then, for me, people feeling their power, beginning to feel power, beginning to participate, but either being elected standing for election themselves or just asking tough questions of the people who are standing in elections. And I think this is a process that people grow into in their life. That said, I want to return to some of the points we've made earlier. Lots of people actually do want to participate, but it's not a very pleasant process in the current circumstances. So to go full circle, you know, here I am speaking to you. I would never stand for electoral politics in this country, never in a million years. And patently, I'm well used to putting my tuppence worth in to conversations.
Thank you for that, Kay. Hannah, what would you like to see the priorities being?
I really agree with Kay's points about the localisation of the spending here. I think there's so many fantastic community grassroots organisations up and down the country that are really engaged with underrepresented, underregistered communities. And I think the opportunity for those groups to connect the work that they do with democratic engagement is absolutely vital. So I'm more into that third sector space rather than local authorities as a method of distribution. And to say that there is kind of growing work in this strengthening our democracy space of third sector groups like ours and others who are interested in this. And there's a real confusion around where we sit regarding funding. Is it political work, in which case, you know, so much charitable giving is then restricted if it's seen as political work? So this confusion between political and democratic outside of government is an issue for those of us, like my organisation, in terms of our fundraising, where actually we would say it's not political at all, but it's about strengthening democracy. And if the government is in a position to contribute to that funding pot, I think there's some really, really, you know, fantastic organisations out there doing really interesting work at engaging communities, and there's just a lack of funding. So we're really supportive of increased funding for democratic engagement. We've been lucky enough to receive some from the Scottish Government ourselves, and it's made an absolutely fundamental difference to the amount of work that we've been able to do. And I believe that we really contributed to the 2% increase in women that were elected in the local election in 2022, and that's directly relation to the money that we were given through the Equality and Human Rights Fund, which we're incredibly grateful for. So I think it does work, and I'd really, really champion the government to continue to grow that fund and really look at what fantastic organisations are on the ground that are able to support in the mission of improving our democracy and getting more people engaged.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Hannah. Becoming a shopping list this slightly. Alan, what do you think the priority should be with funding to increase the democratic
I would agree,
access.
Actually. Yeah, thank you so much, Chairman. And I would agree, actually, in here with Kay and also with Hannah. And we at the Scottish Refugee Council, we've seen during the election in 2021 and also the local election in 2022 that there are even the right to vote for refugees is given to them, but there is still some of the refugees they don't know that they can vote in national and local election in here. So some of the people, they come to us and they were asking us to give them some of that resources. And we work alongside the Electoral Commission to reduce some of the resources in multiple languages and to distribute these resources to the refugees communities that we are working with. But it is still the things that we did. It is small things because we didn't have much fund to work. And also there are some of the refugees communities back to us asking us why, because we translated that resources at the time just only to 5 languages. And there are some of the refugees communities back asking us why you didn't translate it to my language too. And there are some of a lot of works we can work in here, but many of the time the challenge is the funding. So I totally agree. This is area, it can help to encourage people to participate in the democracy. And also I agree with Hannah, it is not about political things, it is about democracy.
Thank you. James, priority?
Yeah, it's quite a wide
quite a wide area, really, isn't it? So one of the things which we've been very happy about is that at the moment in the Scottish general election, there's still a fund there which allows people with disabilities to access it, to give them that additional support they might need to be able to participate in the political process. I think I'm right in saying that includes going through the whatever Byzantine methods of selection different parties have, which sometimes needs a bit of support for somebody to be able to go through. And also the actual standing for election itself. And we are aware of a couple of examples of blind and parasite people who have had some resources. I think it was through Inclusion Scotland, went through it from recollection. And that then, literally, if you just imagine somebody's blind and parasited, if they want to go out canvassing, you know, they literally can't read the voter's record on the, you know, they need to have somebody supporting them in that. And they want to fill in the canvas sheets or on an app or something. They just need that basic bit of support. The society recognises that people with disabilities need additional support in a whole range of ways through the sort of benefits social security system, through access to work, and there are other places where it's recognised that it just costs more money for somebody with a disability to participate in any given aspect of society. So we just like to see that principle sort of extended to democracy, sort of effectively. Another thing I would say as well, and I don't know if this is a good idea or a bad idea, it's off the top of my head, so we'll just go with it, which is we're talking about communications and be able to receive information within the context of a democratic election. I mentioned the one about alt text and how, you know, blind farsighted voters who are on social media, unless somebody describes what the image is, they don't get to see what it is, they don't know what it is. That also pertains to leaflets, parties' leaflets and the materials they put out. And it's, you know, the political parties themselves can't know where a blind parsec person might live, quite obviously, unless they happen to know that for a fact. But nonetheless, they should be, effectively, political parties should be more aware of producing things in alternative formats, not because, I mean, not every single leaflet, that's not realistic, but certainly corporate core stuff. And that might be something which an Access Democracy Fund might support, because understandably the political parties themselves want to target their resources at, you know, certain things, and it might not be generally having lots of accessible information, but if there were some ring-fence fund or some sort of money they could get, which was even across the piece, all political parties could access it if there were a certain level of representation in the Parliament or what have you, that then might be what they could use to get stuff accessible format, not just for blind and farsighted, but easy read and a whole manner of other things. Just a thought.
No, thank you. Just before I come to you, Alice, I think, Hannah, you wanted to just come back in on a point?
No, not quite about this, actually.
That's fine. Then, Alice, I'll come to you and then I'll come back to you. Alice, anything?
Well, we would just say that the ERS is broadly in support of this. We can again look to Wales. It's in its fourth round. It's going well, so we're very much in support. A couple of points would mainly be, rather than proposing suggestions, which I think colleagues here have done a good job of, is just around a point around like transparency and evaluation and making sure that these things are really transparent and how are they being evaluated. We'd like to see that. And also, I guess, around also not getting tunnel vision on just on elections pilots, but looking at between elections those years and, you know, opportunities to strengthen our democracy between elections too.
Thank you. Hannah, can I come back to you?
Sure, thank you. Just before we wrap up, I wanted to make sure there was one key area of interest that we have that isn't directly reflected in the bill, but I wanted to contribute to the conversation, which is around diversity data of candidates. There is no legislation in place at all which requires us to collect the demographic data of those putting themselves forward for election. In 2022, the government did a trial, 2020, the local government candidate survey happened in the last council election, but it had a relative 28% response rate. So we would really advocate for that to be mandatory and to be implemented across all elections. I know the power of that is held with Westminster government around the Equalities Act and Act 106, but that is simply for parliamentary elections. So we would really be advocating for that in local council, because until we have that data, until we know who's standing for elected office, we can't look at who isn't. And we can't look at broadening that pool of candidates. And at the moment, that work is done, but it's individuals scanning websites and making judgments about people based on what they look like. It absolutely is not the robust way that we should be making these decisions. So I really want to advocate for the committee to explore how capturing diversity data in a mandatory way could be incorporated into the bill.
Thank you, Hannah. And actually, that leads me nicely to my final statement, because I know as you leave today, thoughts and ideas will come to you. Please, there is an open invite for you to correspond with the committee, both about the evidence that you've given today. Indeed, as Hannah has done, things that haven't been covered that you would like us to consider, so that we can take all of this into account. I am sadly conscious of time. Can I thank you all for your attendance and actually your contributions today, which have been very thought-provoking. As I say, we are open to any more that you would like to submit for our consideration, and conversations will be ongoing on a number of matters. So can I thank you again, and at that point, can I suspend this meeting just to allow us for a change of witnesses? Thank you. Can I now welcome people back as we resume this meeting? Our second evidence panel consists of Professor Alistair Clark from the University of Newcastle and Professor Toby James from the University of East Anglia. Can I welcome you both to this session? I would like to kick off, really, rather than looking at specific provisions within the bill, what are your thoughts, really, on the integrity of Scotland's devolved elections? Because obviously this bill relates to those. So is Scotland a good example around the world? I don't know who would like to kick off. Alistair, do you want to?
Thanks, and thanks for the invitation to talk to the committee this morning. I mean, I think Scotland has been a good example within the UK and around the world. There's plenty of research that shows electoral administration in Scotland has performed to a high level. I think I'd make a distinction between election administration on the one hand, the actual managing of the ballots, the ballot papers and so on and so forth, and broader systemic issues that occur in the political process. And I think they can impact upon the integrity of elections as well. So the administrative side, research, my own research, others' research has shown that Scotland performs well. I don't think there's room to rest on laurels, however, with this, because, for instance, in the registration field, I think the Electoral Commission found that there was a higher proportion of major errors in the Scottish registers than there were elsewhere. So performing at a high level, but, you know, there's always room for improvement. Those other more systemic issues, issues around foreign influence, cyber security, issues around disinformation, those kinds of issues, I think are probably an issue in Scottish elections as well. I see no obvious reason why Scottish elections should not be affected by those issues as well. And I think what we do about those is less easy to deal with. And indeed, only in some aspects does this bill actually touch on those sorts of things. So I think we need to see it in those two ways and think more broadly about some of those other aspects of election integrity as well.
Thank you. Toby.
Thank you. Yeah, and thank you for the invitation to be able to speak with you about the bill today, which is a great honour. I think the bill, generally speaking, will improve elections, but elections in Scotland are of a very good quality. So I co-direct something called the Electoral Integrity Project, and this facilitates the global comparison of election quality around the world based on expert opinion within each particular country. We undertook a survey of Scottish experts, and the evaluation that they provided overall is of high quality elections in Scotland. Scotland ranked 25th globally. Scotland's elections are higher in quality than elections for the UK Parliament, for example, and pretty much on par with elections in Wales. The area of weakness is voter registration. And that's because there are issues with voter registration across the UK, because as it stands at the moment, the whole of the UK has a single system. That's changing. So the major area of improvement is voter registration. And I think, as the Electoral Commission research has shown, we've got 1 million citizens within Scotland who are not on the electoral roll or whose details are incomplete. So the major opportunity to address that is through automatic or assisted voter registration, and I think that's the area, I think, where there's scope for action kind of going forward.
That's helpful. My other question, I suppose, is the looking glass one. You know, what are the big dangers coming down the line that not just Scotland but all elections in a sense face? Are you able to I'm going to regret this as well, are you able to rank perhaps the threats to the electoral system? Alistair?
I think it's difficult to rank them because some of these were kind of forecasting events that may not mm-hmm. happen. There may be interventions that take place that prevent them from happening. I mean, my general view is that it's issues to do with disinformation. It's issues to do with intimidation. It's issues to do with people putting information online which kind of reveals how they're going to vote, which means that ballot secrecy no longer means quite what it once meant. I think all of these issues are out there and in the mix. And it's not just electoral administrators that are involved in this. It's not just politicians that are involved in this, but it's also private sector actors in the tech field as well. And how you deal with some of these things, I think, well, everybody's struggling with, and I don't think anywhere has really found an answer. So for me, these are the big issues. The administrative issues, I think, are important issues. I mean, it's a massive logistical exercise organising an election. I think in Scotland, the EMB is very much well on top of that and has definitely helped improve Scottish elections. But that's also something that you need to be aware of, supply chains, timetables, which the bill talks about and so on as well. All of those things can impact on the integrity of elections as well. So again, back to those broader questions as well as the administrative mm-hmm. questions.
Toby?
You know, I would agree with that. I think I would also pick out misinformation or disinformation as probably the primary threat that's facing all societies. And this is because, I guess, two things have developed. One is the move to an online environment, which is, you know, becoming ever and ever increasing. But also some evidence of increasingly hostile overseas actors wanting to interfere in elections. Overseas states, there's evidence of that happening. And so when you get high-profile elections, there is a danger that there is going to be an opportunity for overseas actors to want to influence those. Now, the remedies for those problems aren't necessarily laws. I think laws can be helpful. Most of those things may play a role in terms of education, in terms of pre-bunking is often kind of commonly used now to think about what the potential misinformation stories are that could be circulated and to get ahead of those. And that could be particularly important as we kind of go into an electoral cycle. One area where law is relevant, again, is with the electoral register, is with the open or edited register, mm. because that allows the sale of the location of where citizens in Scotland live. That can be bought by anyone for any purpose, and that allows some sort of micro-targeting of individual citizens or citizens in marginal constituencies with misinformation in postal format. So that's something that could be closed. I think Wales is looking at that, mm-hmm. and I would encourage the committee to think about ending the sale of the electoral register within Scotland.
But you still are of the view that the electoral register should be a public document and accessible. It's not to seek remuneration on its contents by selling it.
So there's two versions. Yeah. There's lots of versions of the electoral register. But there's one which is for electoral purposes, the full electoral register, which is used to run the election, and that is needed by electoral officials. It's also needed by other public agencies for other public purposes, such as the crime agencies and so on. There's reason for also making that available for credit referencing agencies because they undertake a purpose. And I think making it accessible also for citizens to check the quality in a limited way is important. Those are all important public reasons for the full electoral register to be shared beyond those purposes. But to sell the electoral register, to make it open access, mm-hmm. It's not the whole register. People do have the option to opt out of that. That is particularly problematic, I think. And so I think closing that loophole is something that the committee, you know, I'd urge the committee to look at doing.
Thank you. I mean, in our previous session, we heard views about candidacy rights, particularly to foreign nationals with limited leave to remain. I mean, I suppose, what are your views on that? What are the unforeseen consequences? What are the challenges? What, indeed, are the advantages? Alistair, if I can come to you first.
Yes, of course. To be honest, I don't find a compelling reason for this to be opened up. I've tried to find advantages in doing so, in thinking why this is being proposed, why it's part of the bill. And it looks to me like a solution in search of a problem, I'm afraid. My view with it is that it's a power that, if it's enacted, will probably be used very, very rarely. For reasons I've given my written evidence, political parties are probably unlikely to seek people to select people without, you know, long links with the party, and so on. And the justification given in the policy memorandum I find less than compelling, and indeed it seems to raise more problems than give actually answers. Scotland already has a very welcoming and open voting regime, which, you know, I think is good. That dealt with a very real problem around Brexit, people who lived here, and so on. So that dealt with a very, very real problem. It's been in the advance with extending the vote to 16 and 17-year-olds. It's got a very liberal voting regime, and I think that's right, makes Scotland a very welcoming place. But this, I don't just really see what the compelling reason for having this is. And unfortunately, it looks like a kind of tidying up exercise. We think we left this out of previous legislation, so let's add it to this one at the moment. And I have tried to think of positive reasons for having this, and I just keep coming up with the idea that this will be a power that will be there, sit on the statute book, and really end up not being used. And I think electoral law is complex enough without clauses there that are never going to be used.
Okay. Toby?
I think this is probably one where there might be mixed opinion amongst academics, as countries are considering this issue in general. I think one argument in favour of it is consistency. As Professor Clark alluded to, these rights have been granted for the basis of being able to cast a vote, so maybe it follows also for candidacy. I guess it's also an argument for, is a matter of principle. It's a matter of making Scotland, as it is, a strong and inclusive society. The one slogan from the democratic movement that's often kind of very widely been used and kind of been echoed is the claim of no taxation without representation. And so the argument is that if citizens are living in a society, they're contributing towards society, they're paying taxes, the decisions that a government is making affect them and their family members, then for that period of time, there's a case for them to have a right to vote, but also to sort of stand as a candidate in those elections. So I think I agree that potentially there'll be very few candidates for the reasons that Professor Clark set out. I think it's more maybe a matter of principle and where Scotland wants to take a stand there.
Can I ask, who do you think has responsibility for ensuring a candidate can legally stand? Where does that rest? Because we've had concerns and slightly different answers. On whom should it, on who does it, and on whom should it rest? Alistair?
It's a good question. I think I've seen your previous evidence, returning officers kind of saying, well, we just take the forms as they are and take things on face value. I think there should be some form of checks of that. I think most people would be surprised that all of this is just taken on on trust. Returning officers, I would imagine, would tell you that they don't have the capacity to do that. And so you then get into a case where it ends up being the law that ends up being the ultimate backstop, and electoral law in this regard is Victorian in how it works, unfortunately, and would not get to a decision in time to prevent someone from standing. It would be something that happened well after the event. I would suspect the Electoral Commission wouldn't want to get involved in that kind of issue either. And so it's really not an easy issue to resolve. My gut feeling is those handling the nomination process should be the ones to be doing some form of check. So that places it largely in returning officers' ballpark and in the, you know, their staffs in local councils. But I would imagine that would be resisted.
So along with the challenge of capacity, they may also need the authority to exactly. be able to check that.
Exactly.
Toby, anything you want to add to that?
Yeah, no, I think it obviously has to be shared responsibility. There has to be some duty on the individual candidate. There has to be some duty on the party, if they are standing on behalf of a party and their agents. On behalf of the electoral authorities, there's, on the one hand, a key role, an informational role, because... Mm. It's complicated, and so they have to be conveyed clearly to anyone so that people can stand if they want to, and it involves also potentially briefings for political parties. I think, as Professor Clark touched on there, the key issue then is checks, you know, mm-hmm. to what extent are checks viable administratively and necessary as part of that process.
Thank you. I'm going to hand you over to Jackie, I think.
Thank you. Good morning. The bill makes provisions for disqualification in certain circumstances. Is there a significant issue with harassment and intimidation of those with involved in elections? You know, candidates, as I said earlier, staff, campaigners here in Scotland. And do you think the provisions on the disqualification orders, are they suitable? Do they go far enough? Professor Clark, you're looking at me, so I'm going to pick on you.
Okay. it's difficult to get a real sense of the level of this as a problem. I mean, there are plenty of accounts saying that it is a problem. The Committee on Standards and Public Life did a report on this probably about 5 years or so ago now. The Electoral Commission have tried to measure it, and I think they did try to measure it in Scotland and came up with a figure of around 40-ish percent, something of that sort, of candidates. And I think it was local elections in the last round in 2022 having experienced some form of intimidation. I think there's a question in my mind, what form of intimidation are we talking about here? Is this stuff that's online, or is this stuff that's in person? I mean, what is the actual nature of the intimidation that's taking place? That doesn't mean it's any less serious in either of those venues, but it might take different forms that people are experiencing. I think there is a problem in Scotland with this. I mean, some representatives would talk about, you know, issues from the independence referendum going forward, that they've experienced issues around this both online and in person. But at the same time, I think it's important to make a distinction here between what passes for normal political robust debate and actually what might be seen as intimidation. And where that line is drawn, I'm not entirely clear. There was one line in, I think it was the Committee on Standards and Public Life's report on this, when they wrote on it in 2017, I think it was, which is they were calling for sanctions for this, but that they didn't want anything that wasn't already illegal being made illegal when making sanctions for this. In other words, not having mission creep with this and including things that weren't already illegal. And that seemed to me to be a reasonably sensible point, I think, to make. In terms of what's in the bill in this, I mean, I think what's in the bill in this is reasonable. I think it's reasonable to extend this to election workers as well, because I have observed elections where I have seen polling station workers in Scotland, you know, being given, you know, the thick end of someone's lip because of something or other. You know, so I think it is reasonable to extend it to election workers as well. But I think what's in the bill in this regard is reasonable.
Okay. Professor James, have you got anything to add?
Yeah, no, I think it's difficult to have, as Professor Clark is saying, full and accurate picture in terms of data. I suspect that there's very low-level issues at the moment, but there is potential for significant issues at a high-level important electoral event in a polarised environment. That's the real potential scenario. Between us, we've done various surveys over the years looking at what happens inside polling station. Most of these have been either UK level or maybe only partially Scotland or maybe in England, but I don't think there's a big difference between England and Scotland in this respect. Local elections, it tends to be that 90% of poll workers tend to report no issues at all with party agents or members of political parties, but 10% do say that maybe they're not being quite where they should be or have encroached perhaps somewhere into the polling station. At the Brexit referendum, we did see a little bit more of an issue there with campaign groups behaving inappropriately, according to returning officers, and 25% of respondents flagged that as an issue. So you can see how, from a local election through to an election where the stakes are really high and things have become polarised. I think part of that is it's not deliberate attempts to undermine the election necessarily. It's people maybe misunderstand the electoral process. If it's a high-stakes election, maybe people who are not usually involved in elections suddenly become campaigners and start to get involved. So knowledge is quite important there, but also tensions can rise. So I think it's something to monitor. And I agree with Professor Clark that I think the proposed bill has an adequate and important measure to help to redress that, but I think it's something to keep an eye on going forward.
Okay, thank you. The Scottish Government's asked the committee to consider whether individuals who appear on the Sex Offenders Register should be prevented from standing or holding elected office, either here in the Scottish Parliament or at local government level. I'd be interested to hear your view on any proposals.
I think it would be one that would be worth looking at international best practice on. I think the Venice Commission, for example, provides a code of best practice for elections. I think following international practices and international standards would be a good way forward. The Carter Centre would also provide a compendium of electoral practices. So I think looking at what international standards are so that any international laws aren't breached would be a good way to take that forward.
Okay, thank you.
I think that would be reasonable. I mean, I think there are circumstances in which, I'm thinking of surgeries and things of that sort, for instance, where elected representatives are in very close contact with constituents. So I can see the logic of thinking in this direction. I don't have a particular problem with it. I think Professor James's point about thinking about international best practice in this regard is useful. I'm not sure what international best practice actually would be in this, nor am I sure there would be anything that either of these organisations have, but I think it's definitely worth a look. I can see the logic, and I wouldn't personally have any difficulty with this from an integrity issue.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Jackie.
Ivan,
I come to you. Good morning to you, and thanks for coming along. I wanted to touch on, firstly, the issue around about the provisions in the bill on notional spending and spend limits for overseas third-party campaigners to bring Scotland into line with reserved elections. And also, I know, Professor Clark, you raised some issues around about reporting periods and timing, all of that as well. So just get your perspective on those issues initially.
Yes. This was one of the big things that struck me in the bill, was that the acceptance that things need to be simplified, that they'll be brought together with the Elections Act provisions. And I think that seems sensible to me, given that it just adds lots and lots of additional complications if there are different regimes. But again, that got me thinking, well, what's not in this bill? And there's a very, very important thing that's not in this bill, which is to do with actually bringing the spending regime for donations, campaign spending, so on, Scottish Parliament elections, into line with those for Westminster elections. They report during an election period weekly, during a general election. Now, it seems to me slightly odd that the Scottish Parliament is less transparent in this regard, and report on a standard three-month schedule, which is out with the election cycle. So we have no idea what's going on with donation spending during a Scottish Parliament election. That may well have been satisfactory back in 1999, but the Parliament has far more powers. There's far more at stake now, I think, in Scottish Parliament elections. So my recommendation would be that the bill goes further, actually, than what's in it already, and actually bring that part of it into line with the regime for Westminster elections as well, to help transparency, because one of the things that the policy memorandum very much focuses on in this regard is transparency. And it seems to me odd that this is something that's not been considered in an attempt to improve transparency. In terms of notional spending, in terms of the restrictions on third-party spending and so on, I think they're fairly straightforward. I think they're fairly sensible. Notional spending, meaning that it has to be something that the agent or the candidate is aware of, that seems to me fairly sensible, I think. And restricting the amount that third parties can spend to £700, I think, is a way of trying to manage some of that potential foreign influence. I would note that the bill goes further in that regard than the Elections Act, however, by also including unincorporated associations in the restrictions on spending. And I think that's an important step, because they have been shown to be avenues for money coming into politics. So I think that's a divergence in the bill that's actually very important. But I would encourage the Scottish Government here to think about more transparency and to take action to improve that even further than we have at the moment, and bring the two regimes more fully into line.
Thank you. Professor James?
The only thing I'd add is to query the spending limit of £700 for overseas-based third parties. I mean, if we're concerned about overseas influence in elections, then should that not be zero? Should we not put a ban on overseas-based third parties being involved in Scottish elections? Otherwise, I agree. Simplification of the bill makes sense, as Professor Clark makes the case strongly for further transparency. I think it's important.
Okay, thanks. Next issue I wanted to touch on was around about digital imprints and the bill's proposals in that area, with this bolt-on provision in relation to unpaid for digital material by relevant third-party organisations. So just to get your perspective on that approach.
To be honest, I don't think we know how either the previous Scottish regime for digital imprints worked, nor do I think we know how this for the Elections Act will actually work. I've not seen any research on either of those things, unfortunately. I think there's one positive thing in this and one potentially negative thing in this that I would bring to the committee's attention. The positive thing is that this extends the imprint regime year-round, if I understand it rightly, and I think that's an important issue, whereas the old Scottish regime was just very much during the campaign period. Extending that, I think, is an important transparency issue. The negative thing is, however, that there seems to be a loophole, to my mind at least, in the Act here, because it says imprints, if reasonably allowable or reasonably possible to include those imprints. And if they're not, you've got to provide a link to wherever they are. Now, what can be done about that? That seems to me to provide a loophole, because people will just say, well, it's not reasonably possible in this post or whatever it is. I think the difficulty is what's in the bill replicates the wording in the Elections Act, as far as I can see. So if we're going to go down that road and replicate that, then I don't see there's much that can be done. If we want to try and tighten that loophole, then I think this is an area that there might be divergence from the Elections Act regime. I think imprints, however, in general in this field, they're a good thing, but quite how they work, they're very, very new. I'm not really aware of any research, and what measures there have been introduced in previous years to try and get a handle on online political advertising have been shown to be fairly ephemeral. So, for instance, I think it was Facebook had a library of political adverts at one point, which just vanished overnight. And that, of course, limits transparency and underlines the problem of having those private sector actors involved here having to come up with information.
Thank you.
I would also welcome the provisions in the bill, but again, to echo earlier comments, it doesn't really address the main problem by itself. So problems with misinformation, for example, are very serious. They're very serious threats. The studies that exist point to the importance of supporting fact-checking mechanisms, supporting journalism, supporting deploying technological tools to detect misinformation. These things have been shown to work. Pre-bunking mechanisms. The digital imprints does help transparency, but it's still a big ocean, and I think there's more that needs to be done.
OK, thank you. Next issue I wanted to touch on was around about the provisions. Do you want me to?
Yeah. My apologies. I just wanted to come in on that point. You say there's not much research in relation to the digital imprints, but in other democracies, I'm thinking of the US, the requirement for a candidate to affirm a message that's put out to the public's existed for a lot longer. Is there research there as to the effect of having that endorsement on it? And is that, I mean, are you aware of any, and is it good or is it bad?
It's a very good question, and I'm not aware of any research that's right. been done on that. At least I've not seen any. I don't know if you have.
Thank you. Sorry.
No problem. Thank you. The next area I wanted to get your perspective on was around about the issue of postponement of elections and the provisions in the bill for that. So specific issues around about publishing a statement of reasons, any tests that should be applied, not decision taken, how and who should take the decision to make sure it's free from political influence. I don't know if you've got any perspective on that.
Sure. I mean, as I've said in my written evidence, I think this is an area where the bill could be strengthened. I think the reasons given in the policy memorandum were less than convincing, to my mind, I'm afraid. And I think the process was also less than convincing. I mean, I think they're right to be thinking about this. The Scottish Government's very right to be thinking about this, because governments were very much caught in no man's land during the coronavirus pandemic and had to enact all sorts of retrospective legislation and things of that sort. So they're right to think about it. I think what I would like to see in the bill is some form of legal test of necessity, because there doesn't seem to be that there at the moment. We're relying on the assumption that the presiding officer says it's necessary and that the chair of the EMB and the Electoral Commission say it's necessary. What we found, and we did research, worldwide research on the coronavirus pandemic, was that these issues around postponement were more likely to be successful if they were cross-party. Because they would then reflect societal agreement about what had to be done. The first thing is to have a legal test of necessity. Now, what test that might be, I'll leave to the committee and Scottish Government, but I've suggested two ideas in my own evidence. Something from the Civil Contingencies Act, perhaps, might be one approach. Something around necessity for derogations from human rights regimes might be another way of thinking about that. If that's in there, then I think that strengthens the bill, but I also think it needs to be strengthened by more than just consultation with the EMB and with the Electoral Commission. They're going to have a very, very important role in telling the presiding officer whether or not this is deliverable or not, an election is deliverable. And that should not be taken lightly, but I think given the time to reflect and put processes in motion, I think some form of cross-party committee or advisory group, I think, would be preferable in this regard, made up of senior politicians who could be nominated by party leaders or whatever, may even be party leaders. But I think, to my mind, that's preferable to get agreement about what the actual necessity to do this is. Because to my mind, there's a danger of kind of fairly routine but rare events being declared an emergency. Not saying that would happen, but I think there's a possibility of it happening. And this is why I think it needs to be tightened up a bit.
Okay, thank you. Mr. James.
I think it's vitally important that this is included in the bill. Unfortunately, unexpected events are going to only become probably more frequent going forward. It's important to have clear provisions. Independence is a really, really important principle, and as is including sort of party stakeholders. One really good example which worked well in the pandemic was actually in Argentina, where they had a cross-party council which pulled everyone together to make a consensual decision about whether to postpone the election or not. So I think including political parties in that is really important. I think having the EMB or Electoral Commission as advisory in that scenario could be seen as potentially a little bit weak, and you can see how the presiding officer could be kind of criticised for taking a partisan position, whether that's true or not. If we think independence is really important, arguably there's a strong case for allowing the EMB for Scotland to be the one that makes the decision rather than the presiding officer.
Thank you.
I think, Edward, you wanted just to come in on that last point.
Just on that and the mechanics of it, the unexpected happening unexpectedly. I think if I remember rightly during COVID that they changed it so MSPs remained in post right up until the day prior to the election. So if there was a crisis, we could come back and sit. So if it's going to be down to MSPs, and it happens once Parliament's been dissolved, there are no MSPs, but there are ministers and cabinet secretaries because they stay in post. So how do you get round that? And do you think some thought process needs to be given to that? Because I'm slightly concerned that if it's allowed to sit with the government, who are the only people who still have people in position, those of us who might have a different opinion won't be heard because we don't exist.
Thank you, and I think that's right. This is a conundrum without a shadow of a doubt. This is why I've suggested the cross-party group, and I think I could maybe go slightly further than I've done already, and it might be possible to have some form of delegated powers or something of that sort in the event of an emergency, something of that sort. But under very tightly controlled circumstances that might enable something to be done. I keep saying something because we don't know what might happen. But I think there is a need for more thought to go into this, undoubtedly. I think the contrary, however, is that leaving MSPs in post until a day before, I think, was reasonable during the pandemic. We've got a bit of leisure of time here. And I think you end up in that position where you have MSPs not on a level playing field with the other candidates. I'm sure the other candidates would complain. And I can see the logic of that argument. So I think it is something that needs to be resolved. And this is why I think maybe that advisory committee could have some delegated power in the event of an emergency or something.
Sorry, can I push back slightly on that, Camina? I absolutely agree with MSPs remaining in post and okay. the fact that it may give them a difficulty. Where my fear is that if you have an advisory committee, you know, how do you weight the votes? Because the weighting of the votes, if it's done like in the Bureau, it would be purely down to the government in this situation. And if they've got an absolute majority, then the advisory committee would be a waste of time. I personally favour a outside organisation taking control. So I wonder, Toby, you sort of suggested that. I maybe just push you slightly to answering and then come back to Alistair.
Yeah, no, I think to have an independent body making that decision does insulate Parliament and politicians in some regard. I think you still need to include politicians in that conversation because they have important views and you want to take everyone along with you. But if you was to make it an external body making that decision, then that would be a little bit clearer.
Alistair, you're kind of nodding, but...
I'm kind of nodding. I mean, I can see completely the logic of your argument. I mean, but that then subverts the normal role of authority. The role of authority is for politicians to take the decisions, not officials. And I think, you know, the EMB, I think, has been a wonderful organisation for improving the quality of Scotland's elections. They've done a lot of good work, but... Should that be put on the shoulders of whoever the convener of the EMB happens to be? I'm not necessarily sure it should be. This is partly why I suggested the cross-party issue. And I've also suggested in my written evidence the fact that there could be a particular sort of majority limit, supermajority perhaps, or something of that sort, for this advisory committee to be made to prevent the circumstance that you've suggested about the government. I think this is one that could go round and round several times.
Convener, probably I'd just leave it, stop it going round and round, but just to say that I do think that actually this needs a little bit clearer thought because, you know, we have to expect the unexpected, and if COVID taught us nothing, it's that, and some of the decisions we made in the build-up to... or during COVID, I think, were fundamentally flawed from democracy's point of view.
Annie, can I come to you?
Yes, thank you, Convener. Thank you for being here and thank you for your written submissions as well. I just would like to touch on the electoral pilots, if I may. Obviously, there is provision in the bill to extend them out, which I think the majority of our witnesses agreed with, that's a good thing. We also heard in our previous... evidence sessions from the Electoral Reform Society that we think a trick has been missed when it comes to voter registration. So I wonder if you could just maybe expand on should this be a pilot indeed, and if so, what approach should be taken? And I'll come to Professor James first, please.
So, yes, I think the bill is missing a trick. I think voter registration is probably the biggest issue facing Scottish elections, one of the biggest issues facing UK elections. Automatic voter registration is something which many countries around the world have now adopted. Some had it out from the start, but countries that have had a similar system to the UK, where it's been an individual responsibility, have adopted these bolt-on ways of increasing voter registration rates because they've experienced the same problem that we have, ever-declining levels of voter registration. Mm-hmm. So I think that how do you make that happen? You need to give returning electoral registration officers the right to register an elector without application where they have confidence in that person is who they are and they are eligible for the election. Mm-hmm. And you need to increase the data sources that they can receive so that they can make those applications. Mm-hmm. I think you need to put that legal provision in first so that they pilots can then be mm-hmm. run on that basis. So you can, and I think inevitably there is then going to be a learning process of working out which data source is the best one, mm-hmm. which can be used, which has the greatest impact. It's unrealistic to to think that we can move to full automatic voter registration. Mm-hmm. In fact, it's just going to be adding particular groups at particular moments in time. So, for example, adding 16-year-olds or 15-year-olds mm-hmm. to the electoral register when they receive their national insurance number. That's one step. And I think thinking about it in terms of life moments for the voter and combining voter registration with that, it could boost the quality of the electoral registers. It could save people a lot of work who are already writing to these people, asking them to register to vote, and they're not doing it. So there's actually cost savings to be mm-hmm. made here as well.
Professor Clark, if you get anything to add.
A couple of things. I'm not sure how you would pilot automatic right. voter registration, because almost by definition, I think that would need to be a nationwide reform, as is happening in Wales. And I think the idea of a pilot is to do something on a localised area to try and learn lessons from it. So I'm not quite sure how that would work. Maybe some of the backroom administrative processes that might build into an automatic voter registration system could be trialled on that basis. Mm-hmm. But the actual automatic registration aspect of it, I'm less sure about. But what you could do on a step to that road is trial what's known as assisted voter registration, mm-hmm. where you get public services, Toby mentioned life moments mm-hmm. for voters, things of that sort, to keep reminding electors that mm-hmm. that you have to register. It's an individual responsibility. Here's how you do it. Provide them with information and so on. I think that would be possible to be piloted in various areas. Mm-hmm. And I think if there's going to be anything in registration in the form of piloting, I'd send people down that avenue rather than necessarily thinking about automatic. As a stepping stone, I would assume, towards a wider aim.
Yeah, no, I completely see where you're coming from. And I think using the life moments is sort of an ideal way to go about it. The other challenge that we do have in particular is turnout at elections, and it's particularly challenging among some groups in some areas. And I was just wondering, is there an approach which Scotland should be considering to improve turnout at elections?
This is something that all countries are dealing with. And, you tend to have higher turnout for the national parliament, lower turnout for the local government elections. It's a well-established effect. Because people think there's more at stake in the parliamentary elections and local government, rightly or wrongly. Scotland doesn't do too badly in local government elections, actually. I think it's around 45% or so, which... it's not great, but it's much better than it is in England, mm-hmm. which is generally around the mid-30s. So Scotland's not quite so bad in that regard. I think it's a case of keep reminding people. And I think, whether this be, in interactions with public bodies, remember mm-hmm. there's an election coming up. And indeed, I've seen some adverts around this on my way here and yesterday, which I think is a good thing. But it's also incumbent, I think, on political parties to do mm-hmm. mobilisation here. And in this discussion, we always end up thinking about, what can the Electoral Commission do? What can returning mm-hmm. officers do? And so on. But political parties are reluctant, I think, sometimes to understand their role in mobilising voters as well. And there is plenty of research evidence suggests that where parties have active local campaigns, mm-hmm. that benefits turnout as well. So I'd encourage parties to step up to the plate in that regard. There is one thing which is well beyond the scope of this bill, but always amazes me that we don't talk about in any form when we talk about this issue, and that's mandatory voting or compulsory mm-hmm. voting. Mm-hmm. Because this has been shown not just fairly obviously to increase turnout, but also to resolve inequalities between social groups in turnout. Now, I have no view one way or the other of whether that mandatory voting is right or wrong, but it strikes me as odd that if we want to improve turnout and resolve inequalities between social groups, we don't even speak about it. That's for a broader conversation, I think. It's beyond what the committee can do or discuss here.
So yeah. There's lots of factors that shape whether an individual votes, and we can't attempt to shape them all. I mean, in terms of pilot ideas, in addition to voter registration, then some of the ideas might include the use, I think, as you've heard before, of digital poll cards. They potentially could make a difference if someone receives an email on the day of the election reminding them, a personalised email reminding them to vote. There is also scope for introducing or piloting a vote anywhere option. It sounds easy, it's complicated. At the moment, we have to vote in a particular polling station. If many countries have digital electoral registers, so they're integrated, which means that you could, in fact, go into any kind of polling station, cast your vote there, rather than a particular one. That would make a difference for people, but it is complicated to get to that point. I think you were hearing in the previous evidence, small pots of money for community groups that are really, really important. Sometimes we have some good ideas, but the people that really have really, really good ideas are potentially those marginalised groups who have low voter turnout. So, you know, there's been lots of youth groups, for example, who've been very, very effective at getting votes out, going into schools, doing voter engagement, voter outreach, but their funding sources are very limited, they're very unstable, and so what then happens is good ideas work in a particular small geographical area, and then they have to go on to other jobs, other careers, and things that peter out. So that's the stability and learning from those pots of money, I think, is really, really important.
Can I just add one thing? I mean, in terms of pilots, I think it's very important that there's a clear objective set out for them. It's not just doing pilots for pilots' sake, but also that they are properly independently evaluated, and it's not just the government marking its own homework on this. And I think that's actually really important. All too often, we don't see that happening. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you.
Just to come back on the registration, we've talked about being registered. How long should you stay on the register?
I think we've moved to a system of the reformed canvas, which now works very, very well. It wasn't called this, but it's actually automatic re-registration.
Yeah.
We talk about sometimes as if automatic registration is like some fanciful idea, but we have automatic re-registration. Electoral authorities are using data to check that we haven't moved, and therefore are keeping us on the register if other data sources verify that's who we are. And I think that's as it should be. That system seems to be working particularly well.
Thank you. Edward, I was going to come to you.
Yep, I get all
with an indication of the time, just.
And I get all the easy questions at the thing. So, first question is for non-devolved elections, you can vote overseas, and the committee would like your views on whether people should be allowed to, and whether it would be safe to allow people to vote in the Scottish elections from overseas. Do you have a view on that?
I think the biggest problem with voting from overseas in non-devolved elections are two things. One are the deadlines that are set for people doing this. And secondly is the mode of how it's actually done. It involves sending ballot papers to rare and remote places all around the world, which may or may not arrive in time to tight deadlines. And we hear plenty from these voters about them not getting back in time and only receiving the ballot paper after the polling day and things of that sort. So there's a need for thinking about the mechanics of how that would be done if that's the case. That thinking has not been done for reserved elections, unfortunately. But there is a need to think about how might those sorts of things be dealt with. There could be some form of secured online delivery of ballot papers or something of that sort. Other countries manage these things through the consulates, for instance. But that would be my main issue, I think about how it's done so that these votes could actually play a part, importantly, and be counted.
If it can be done?
If it can be done, I don't really have an objection to it.
Toby?
Yeah, I agree. I think the main issue is logistical. There have been some experiments around the world with online voting, but actually they've largely been unsuccessful in that regard. That hasn't been successful. Postal voting, you know, it doesn't work because the time is available. Embassies is one way which does work, but in practice, which country do you put? Do you open up to all embassies? So in practice, you're only really ever able to get a few people cast their votes. Does it matter again symbolically for people that still feel part of a country? It probably does. I think one thing to throw in is, you know, do we want an indefinite right to vote, or is the 15-year limit, as it was for UK parliamentary elections, a sufficient kind of threshold? I think that's something to consider. 15 years seems long enough in some ways if people already have moved and are now part of another society. But again, it's a matter of principle, I think.
Okay. I think it's interesting, and I think those people who are sent away to do things on behalf of the country, service personnel and such, we need to make sure we get that right. So, next question. I don't know why I got this one, actually. Dual mandate, challenges and opportunities. What do you think? We heard in the last panel that they weren't keen on dual mandates, and that if you were you had to resign, you couldn't do both. A lot of work, perhaps. What do you have a view on it?
My view is that, I mean, they use a term in Northern Ireland, double jobbing, for this, and my view is that it's probably best that it doesn't happen.
I agree.
Okay, I'm definitely leaving that one there then. I would tend to agree that I think a job as an MSP is a full-time job. Yes. And I struggle to find time to do much else on occasions. Very important one, this for me. Graham Simpson's producing a bill, which you will have seen, on recall. You know, the electorate must have, in my opinion, the right to recall people if they're not performing. We do it in council, so okay. There's no reason why we shouldn't do it in the Scottish Parliament. Slight issue for the likes of me as a regional MSP. First of all, do you think it's right? And how do you get around the problems with regional MSPs? Because that's, you know, more than one constituency you'd have to consult. And we saw how difficult it was earlier. Last year it was, wasn't it, that we had a recall petition?
We did, Margaret Ferrier. And I think it's reasonable to have that as a provision. But you're right about the complication of regional lists. I think Graham Simpson's proposal, for me, makes sense, which, as I understand it, is that the equivalent of the constituency petition happens, but in that region. What I wasn't quite clear about is whether or not the limit's set at 10% there. But I think that seemed to me to be a reasonable way of thinking about it. How it will work, I mean, we only have limited experience with this at Westminster, and there have been, in a couple of occasions, complaints that it's probably not worked as well as it should have done, that awareness, maybe things of that sort of nature. But we're now five recall petitions, I'm right in saying, and I think they seem to have settled down. The reasons for calling them are to do with suspensions, criminal, being convicted of a criminal offence, and there's a third one which escapes me for the moment. Which I think seem reasonable. I mean, I think there should be a fairly high bar to an MSP being recalled to begin with. I think I'd be worried if I saw this becoming, you know, something that just became part of normal political debate in that regard.
I guess, for a country to you, Toby, is the problem with the regional one is that does it mean the next person steps up on the list if that it, because it, it's done on party vote share, because you can't go back out and do the whole regional list again. I have a real concern that, you know, regional MSPs should be held to account just the same as constituency MSPs. So I don't know how you do that.
That's the complication, and I mean we've seen that when there have been by-elections in local government, for instance, that other parties have won the council seat under single transferable vote. Different electoral system, obviously, for the regional list. And to be honest, I don't really have a problem with the proposal that's in Graham Simpson's bill. And perhaps political parties should do a bit more to perhaps vet their candidates and so on to begin with. And then we may not end up in those sorts of circumstances anyhow.
You can try, and sometimes there's always an odd one that sneaks in. Toby, right. Do you want to know?
Just to echo that, I mean, I think they're a really, really important accountability check on office holders. I think in an era where we have low political engagement, distrust of public office holders across the board, to enable citizens, if they can realise they can actually call someone back, I think it can only be strong for democracy, and hopefully it's impossible to measure, it encourages better conduct in office if office holders know that there are some, you know, they're not untouchable as it were. So I would support the measure.
In the hope that I'm not the odd one that sneaked in, convener, back to you.
Thank you very much. I wanted to just press you really about the Electoral Commission and in relation to the five-year plan. And obviously there's a slight shift in power balance between Wales and up here about who has the final say on it. And it's really just to explore your views as to which the better route to take would be. I don't know, who is it? Toby, would you like to start? Or?
Sure. So principles of independent electoral authorities are really important, and I think that echoes back to the debate we had earlier on about election postponement, who should have the final word there. And in many countries, therefore, the electoral authorities do have, do have much greater independence than potentially they do in the UK. I would say the move to a five-year plan makes sense. It brings the Commission's activities in line with the Scottish electoral cycle, so that makes sense. But ultimately, I would support the Electoral Commission having the final say in terms of if there is an issue on what they're proposing to do.
Okay. Alistair?
I don't have a problem really with a delegated committee of the Parliament having a say on this. My working assumption is that this would proceed largely by consensus to begin with. And the Electoral Commission is a body of statute, basically. It is responsible to the UK Parliament. It's now responsible to the Senate. It's responsible, obviously, to the Scottish Parliament as well. So I have less concern about there being a role for the Parliament in this regard. I think I do share concerns about the independence of the Electoral Commission, but I don't think this would be comparable with something like the strategy document that the UK government have tried to impose on the Speaker's Committee at Westminster. My feeling by what's in the bill is that this would be a fairly iterative process between whichever committee and the Commission. And I think the Commission itself has generally says it's welcoming of scrutiny. So I've probably not answered the question definitively, but I can and do see perhaps a bit more of a role for the Parliament in this regard.
And the other point I wanted to explore is about the legal entity that is the EMB and a proposal for body corporate. Presumably, you're reasonably relaxed given the contractual requirements that the EMB have, that it has a legal entity. And if that being the case, I would push down to the proposal that of two deputy convener posts to, in essence, have someone else for the two separate and distinct roles, and just really to collect your views on that.
And I think these proposals, are, to my mind, are uncontroversial. I mean, I think the Electoral Management Board, as I've said already, has been a positive development in administrating Scotland's elections. It really has brought a consistency that probably wasn't in evidence before, as we saw difficulties in 2007. Should it have legal... be a legal entity, yes, because that should allow it to enter into contracts and things of that sort. So the e-counting system for local government elections, I think, is probably the major contract that's involved in Scottish elections, would be one thing that could remove that from the government, for instance. There will no doubt be other things, economies of scale and things of that sort. In terms of deputies, I think that's entirely reasonable as well. I mean, it's proceeded largely on a volunteer basis up until now, and... it's a complex world. Logistically, I think it's underappreciated just how complex this is. Not only is electoral law complex, but the actual, producing of everything that needs to go into running an election is complex. So I think, having two deputies makes perfect sense to me.
I think it makes complete sense, so I'd support the proposal. I think it's quite troubling in a way that the organisation that's has played such an important role in the past, has been so important for delivering Scottish elections, is reliant on in-kind contributions from other organisations and other individuals, really. I think the putting it onto a firmer statutory and financial basis is really, really important. And I think the word there, complexity, is coming up a lot. There's a myriad of different organisations involved in delivering elections. It makes no sense to the voter. So I think at some point it might be worth thinking what is the best way to deliver elections in Scotland organisationally. And the variety of organisations that we've got have kind of come up through for historical reasons, partly through the different logics of devolution, of course. But, in many countries there is a single electoral management body, and that delivers voter elections and voter registration, and it has a clear remit, and it's clearer for voters to know where to go to if they want to raise a complaint or if they have an issue, which website they go to, where do they go through. We don't really have that anywhere in the UK. Instead, it's increasingly becoming more complex and difficult to navigate. So I think the bill's fine. The bill makes a lot of sense. But at some point, maybe it's worth sort of putting a foot on the ball and thinking, what's best for Scotland?
Okay, convener's last mischievous question. Elections belong to the people of Scotland, but who should oversee it, the legislature or the government? Alistair?
The easy one to finish with.
Absolutely.
I think ultimately the legislature. The government will be involved in helping the administration of it. I think that's unavoidable, but I think it should be the legislature that has the final word.
Toby?
Yeah, I agree.
Excellent. If there's anything that you would like us to consider, once you've had an opportunity to consider again what you've told us today, please feel free to write to us. And I hope you wouldn't mind if we in turn take the opportunity, if we have additional questions, to come back to you. But can I thank you very much for your evidence today and for attending in person. Thank you. And I'll now close the public part of this meeting.